Yeah. Yeah. All right, we're gonna do this today. We're gonna do this. We're gonna do this. We're gonna do this. We're gonna do this. Okay, so basically, I said I was gonna do it. I was true to my word. But I got this article from Boxing News yesterday evening. And basically, we have the Thurman. We got the Thurman fight coming up soon. Keith's going to be doing his thing, swinging in. But before that, we have to do a little history on the sport. And like the first fight they brought up, I never heard about the fight. I heard about one of the fighters. I've heard of Joe Dundee before, but I never heard about him or Jackie Fields in any in-depth measure. So that fight took place in 1929. In 1929, I believe Joe Dundee was the world champion. And I think he lost the belt. He lost the belt. Did he lose to Fields? I haven't even got the whole story. I haven't even got the whole story. I mean, maybe I'll do it again. But the NBA belt was just coming into play, and Jackie Fields won the NBA belt. So it was a unification bout in sorts where they were trying to clear up who was supreme at 147. And Joe Dundee was disqualified. He was disqualified, and Fields obviously had both belts. The NBA, for those that don't know, is the WBA, National Boxing Association, World Boxing Association. The oldest belt in transition, so to speak. So there's a little shot of Joe Dundee in the picture there. Put a little shot up of Jackie. Jackie. Let's put up Jackie Fields. One sec. Here he is. Where's Jackie at? There he is. This is Jackie Fields. That's Jackie Fields. I know Jackie Fields, he did fight Gorilla Jones. That was a black middleweight champion, who was formidably strong. I think he beat him and drew with him. That kind of impressed me, that a welterweight could hang in there. Like, Gorilla Jones was a physical middleweight, big, strong black guy, and like, and he had numerous amount of contests. He was never stopped. I don't think he was flawed or anything. Like he was really tough, and he was one tough champion. And the fact that he could hang in there with him, it just shows you how tough the welters back then, and just the fighters period, were back then. Very tough indeed, extremely tough, man. So that was the first unification bout as such. You know what I mean? Like, what would be good if some of you are on the hangout while I'm running this, if you could bring up some stuff about Jackie Fields or Joe Dundee, and I'll read it out. That would be good. That's what you call excellent participation, and I'd appreciate that. I would appreciate that. That'd be really good, because I don't know much about either man. I don't know much about either man, in all truth. So we're one down. We're one down. We're one down, people. We're one down. We're one down. So we're gonna go to the next. The next one, it takes a long time to get there. It's surprisingly big gap in between these two fights. Jackie Fields, which was 1929, and Joe Dundee. Surprisingly long gap, and it's this one here. And this is probably, I don't know, this fight here, man, I don't even know how to describe it, man. As a boxing fan who experienced the 80s, I don't have to describe these two boxers. I don't know. These guys are superheroes to me, man. They're in the superhero league of boxing, man. This was in 1981. Sugar Ray Leonard took on Thomas Hearns. Banging. Yo, what's up, Dee? Dee Obianuli, one of the mods, one of the moderators. Yeah, man. Just a classic. A classic bout, man, you know. One of the best ever, man. One of the best ever. You've got the cinema exchange between Ray Leonard and Angelo Dundee. You're losing it, son. You're losing it. Leonard's eye was swelling up. Fast rate. I mean, and Hearns was raking him up on the jab. Apparently, you know, Leonard retired later on in his career a couple of times because of detached retinas. They say Tommy Hearns' jab done that damage, boy. I'll mess with that jab, that 79-inch reach. It wasn't no joke. It wasn't no joke, man. Like, I can't give you an in-depth breakdown at all on Joe Dundee and Jackie Fills. This one I know. This fight I know, yeah? This one I do know, man. And Leonard is just like, I don't know how Leonard pulled that fight out, man. I don't know how he pulled it out. You're talking about a Tommy Hearns who was just flattening everyone, man. You know? And when I say KO, like unconscious KOs, Duran was unconscious. Cuevas was just in bad shape, man. these guys were just getting folded up. Contenders like Pablo Baez, I think he just took all of them out, man. Tommy just, I mean, like, Tommy was in charge, man, but Leonard, he started working the midriff. Leonard started working the midriff hard. He started working it hard, man. And he had incredibly fast hands, Leonard. That's why when people are, who would win out of Floyd and Leonard? I have to remember how fast Leonard's hands were, man. Leonard's hands was, Floyd's never fought no one with hand speed like Leonard. Never. No one. Not even Zab Judah. Well, Zab Judah is probably comparable, but he just doesn't have the same chin and the same, he's just not as good as Ray. Just nowhere near. You know, Ray's just started throwing his machine gun type combinations. What they call shoe shine combos. He was just brilliant at them, man. And like, he just started working Hearns over. The combinations were sick. The combinations Ray Leonard was throwing was absolutely sick. Some of the sickest in boxing history, man. And as you can see here, Tommy went out the ring ropes, you know. Just took an absolute beating. Tommy just started taking a beating. And I remember the last combination. Leonard went to the body. Then a couple to the head, I think it was. And the referee had to get in there, man. The referee had to get in there and bail him out. And bail him out, man. Great fight, though. Absolute great, great fight. Great fight. Great fight. I wasn't following boxing when this was on. I wasn't following it. This is 1980. I wasn't following it like that. I saw this about 1983 when I started really getting into it deep. You know, I saw the whole fight. And, yeah, man, ring fight of the year, you know. Yeah, that's right. Thomas Hearns took out Pablo Baez just before he took out, well, he faced Sugar Ray Leonard. Randy Shields, you just defended that title numerous amount of times. WBA champion, and Leonard was the WBC champion. Great. Great, 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 great fight, man. Great fight. And the finish was just like Leonard, just wow, wow. Excellent, excellent. 14th round, man. 14th round. 14th round. You see? Like, man, hopefully I'm going to do some videos with blood boxing soon, hopefully. And blood always goes to the gloves. You know what I mean, man? You lady made a fight in them gloves, man. I don't know. If I was going to take something back from the old school, I'd like some of these fights to go 15. That's what I like to. I like to see some of them go 15 rounds. Now, maybe in 2017, they might find information that tells us that's not a good idea. But at the time they blocked 15 rounders, if you dig deep into it, it wasn't because they done any empirical study that it damages championship fighters. There was no empirical study done on that. You know, from what I hear, it was for advertising purposes to, you know, and to shorten the programming for the networks and a lot of other referees. But yo, that's just a clap. That one there, classic unification. And there you see it there, Sugar Ray Leonard, WBA, WBC champion, TKO, 14th round, ring fight of the year. You see the scorecards, 125, 122. See, you don't see them scorecards today because the fat fights don't go that far. It's odd to see that, isn't it? It's odd to see it, 125, 121. And that was in favor of Hearns. Hearns was up on all the scorecards, yeah? 125, 122, 125, 121, 124, 122. Leonard was cutting the range down. So it was going to be very tight on the scorecards. Because let's remember, you're in the 14th, you already had a 10-8, which wouldn't have been totaled up, I guess. Absolute. Oh, man. Wow. If anyone was around back then and you was watching these kind of fights, like at the start of you being a boxing fan, it was just hard. It was hard not to be a boxer, like to get hooked into it. It was like crack. Fighters like Leonard and Hearns made boxing like crack. That's what it did. It made it like crack cocaine. That's what it did. You know? That sounds like a bit of a mad analogy. Maybe so, but that's exactly what it was. That's what it was. Yeah. Leonard made 11 million. Hearns made a fortune himself. Super fight. Now, you see when guys talk about, oh, yeah, this, you've probably heard me go nuts on the hangout when these guys talk about super fights. No, that's a super fight. That's a super fight. You know, some of this bullshit they're trying to pass off. They ain't no super fight. They don't know what they're talking about. You wouldn't know a super fight if it fucking smacked you in the fucking nose. Yeah? You will know a super fight if it smacked you in the goddamn nose. Yeah? And we're going to go into this one here next, man. Let me break down the data. Yeah. We're going to do this one, man. All right. Let me set it up. Nice. All right. The pictures, you know, because they didn't have no high-def cameras back then. So when you get the pictures of some of these things, it's just not that impressive. So, okay, let me focus in the picture. All right. Let me see. There we go, application window, picture. All right. Share this one. What date is it? Let me go to the date. It's 1985. It's the WBA champion and the IBF champion, Donald Curry, against the WBC champion, Milton McCrory. That's what this is, you know. And, let me just make sure I got everything correct here before I start yapping off. Okay, here we go. Don Curry, tap in source and Osric. All right, well, I tapped in Curry's electric products there, which is no good. All right, so let me do that again. I was all about a washing machine or a fucking microwave. Okay, Don Curry. The Lone Star Cobra. Great fighter in his prime, man. Great fighter. great fighter, man. That's all I know. That's all I know. Now, Curry won the title, the vacant title from Yun Suk Hwan. And what they don't have is that, and what BoxRec have admitted is that he was actually on the canvas and it was a 15 rounder. The scorecard is 146, 139. It was a 15 rounder. Curry rose from the canvas and outpointed the guy. Apart from the knockdown, it was a excellent boxing performance, you know, as per usual. Don Curry from Fort Worth, Texas. Pure excellence. Pure excellence. He already had a victory over Marlon Starling. As a contender, he beat guys like Bruce Finch, good contenders. And he was a pound-for-pound stalwart, was Don Curry. By the time he defended that title against Marlon Starling in the rematch and outpointed him over 15, he was he pound-for-pound then? Probably near the time he fought Colin Jones, he was pound-for-pound. Probably near about that time there. You know, he was rising fast. By the time he fought Hunnigan, he was pound for pound. And Milton McCrory from the Kronk Gym, he was the WBA champion. He was a very tall, elongated guy. Very tall. Good jab. And he was a little underrated, in all truth. Milton was a little underrated. Milton was a good fighter. Milton was very good. But Manny Stewart was a little bit hesitant of throwing in with Don Curry, because we knew Curry's counter-punching skills and power and precision. Like, Curry would basically just stay right on your chest and dare you to shoot and encounter you up and mess you up, bro. Mess you up. I remember the time, man. Listen, I remember when Curry came to the United Kingdom, man, and he fought Colin Jones. And Milton McCrory fought Colin Jones twice. One fight, the first fight was a draw for the WBA title. And the second one, was it a split? A split decision and a draw, I think it was. Very tight fights. Colin Jones was from Wales in the United Kingdom. And let me tell you, man, Don Curry came to the UK. Where was it? I can't remember what the arena it was, man. And I was watching it with my dad. I remember I was watching it with my dad, man. And Curry done this counter. And let me tell you about Colin Jones. Was a massive puncher, a horrible puncher. He was a big puncher. He knocked out Kirkland Lang twice in the same round. In the same circumstances, behind the points. And he won the European title, flattening people out. He was a top contender. He was tough as anything. Good fighter. And Curry done this job. He didn't knock him out, but he just tore his... The cut that he put on his nose bridge was horrible. Horrible. He just sliced him up, just dissected him. And he did it right up in the guy's face, and a big punch his face, right up in his face. And I remember my dad, because my dad used to box. My dad was just impressed. I saw that. My dad was just highly impressed with Don Curry, boy. Highly impressed. That's what I remember. That's what I remember, man. And Milton McCrory, how much he made about... four or five defenses. So he was becoming, you know, he was starting to develop a little something, man. He was starting to develop a little reputation. And then there was nowhere really to go for him. He didn't really beat anyone outstanding before he took on Curry. Let me see the challenges. Let me put a box rock up. Who did he fight? First fight with Jones, yeah, a draw. I remember that. And then a split decision. That was for the vacant title, the vacant WBC title. And then guys like, you see, Milton Guess, Pedro Vieira, who actually beat Marlon Starling once, Luis Santana, Santana, Carlos Trujillo, not great fighters, but he was coming into his own. Like when he, by the time he fought Santana and Trujillo, he was stopping a couple of them now, you know. And there was nowhere really to go. I remember the KO magazine was very popular at the time, very popular, and word was going around the American boxing scene that the Kronk were ducking the fight. They were ducking the fight, basically. You know, they didn't believe in McCrory. You know, they didn't, but they didn't believe that McCrory could do it, man. Then, you know, it happened, it went ahead. I'm just gonna show you this slide here. I don't think they'll be able to do me for it because it is on the Google images. I don't think they'll be able to do me. So I'm gonna stop this. You'll be able to see a bit of Don Curry's handiwork. Okay, is this it? Yeah. Present. All right, if you can see the little caption, look at the left hook, man. Look at that left hook. Look at his left hook. Look at the balance. Look at the balance. Sick. Absolutely sick. Like, the fight took place, and listen, it was nearly, I remember reading the boxing news when they done the breakdown on it, and they said, in the first round, I remember reading it vividly, they said in the first round, Curry went to make one attack and he kind of stumbled as he made the attack. No punch was landed, but he kind of went off balance. And he said, and the writer said, that spoiled nearly a perfect, absolutely picture perfect performance. Curry was outstanding. The first left hook there, you're seeing there, you can see the balance. You can just see the balance. You can just see the technique. You can just see it. You can just see the balance, the technique is nearly spot on. Yeah? For one. That's number one. I mean, look at it. If you can't see it, oof. And that ain't nothing. This is in the second round. That's the first knockdown. McCrory gets up, man, and Curry just walks over and lands this bomb of a right hand. Bang! And McCrory just on the floor looking up round at the ring lights. Fight done. Absolutely outstanding. Outstanding, man. And at this time, Curry, you know, was calling out Leonard. He was talking about fighting Hagler. And the world was his. But it's just a cruel game, boxing, man. It's a cruel game. One fight after that, he lost the title to Lloyd Hannigan, man, in Atlantic City. Just got the title ripped away from him. Just ripped away. And then after that, you know, he won a title at Super Welter. Mike McCallum knocked him out. And, you know, it was downhill. It was downhill from there. It's just amazing how your fortunes can change. You can be the man at the top, but boxing, you just don't know. You just don't know when your time's gonna run out, I guess. Because I didn't see all that coming, man, for Curry. I didn't see him just slipping down and ascending down the welterweight rankings like he did. I didn't see it coming. No one did. I don't think no one did. No one saw it coming. And that was that. Any comments from the guys? We've got MAS 45678. We've got my man Coppin, another moderator, Coppin 09. Would you bring 15 rounders back? And why did they get rid of them in the first place? Well, I said it earlier, is there was no clinical study to say that it was a threat to the boxer's health. From what I was told, it was for so they could get more ads into the programming, cut down the broadcasts, you know, and stuff like that, you know, rather than the excuse that they gave it. Coppin 09, he says, they didn't boo boxers, runners back then. Sugar Ray, running versus Hagler would have got booed today in the USA. Yeah, yeah. It's true. And that was on HBO. HBO didn't used to do all that shit back then. That's very true. Although in saying that, Conor Whitaker did used to take a bit of abuse. But generally, no, it wasn't like today. There wasn't this, there wasn't an agenda like there is today. That they're using the running thing as part of their agenda. It wasn't really there back then like that. It wasn't really there. That is actually true. I have to concur with that. So where do we go next? Where do we go next, Beats? Beats, where we going next, brother? Simon Brown versus Maurice Blocker. Let me put some of the action on the screen. Simon Brown versus Maurice Blocker with some. Right, these two guys were really good friends. They were both from the Washington area, you know. I should have wrote down some notes, but, you know, I just didn't bother, man. Didn't have time. And both from the Washington area. Simon Brown is from Jamaica. He's from Jamaica, but he grew up in Washington. And Maurice Blocker was a thin, tallish-looking guy. He was way stronger than what he looked like. I remember Hannigan making one of his first defenses from the title. He took it from Curry. And I was thinking, man, this guy can't stand up to Hannigan, man. But he fucking pushed Hannigan hard, man. He pushed him really hard. He had them long-ass arms. And he was taking Hannigan's shots, man, and firing back. Like, it was a great fight. It was a great fight. It really was a great fight, man. Has to be said. And how did he get the fight again? This is a unification. I'm trying to figure out where he won the belt. That's come right out of my head right now. Right. He lost that to Marlon Starling. Right. I'm a Simon Brown. Right. Simon Brown. That's right. Simon, he had the classic fight with Tyrone Trice. I interviewed Tyrone about this fight here. This was for the vacant IBF belt. And Box Records, they missed a lot of this stuff here. Tyrone actually had Simon Brown on the deck and was, you know, giving him the business till Simon pulled it out. Once again, 15-rounder. He got stopped in the 14th. Great fight. One of the greatest welterweight bouts. Tyrone Price and Simon Brown. Great fight. You know, he took out Jorge Vacco, gave Lloyd Hannigan all sorts of problems. And Simon was a good champion, man. Excellent champion. Made loads of defenses. Yeah, he beat Jorge Maisonet, who was a very big puncher in his own right. Bobby Joe Young, who ended Aaron Price's career. I remember him taking out Al Bumblebee Long. Saw that on television. He beat Tyrone Trice again. A bit of a war, but it was a little easier this time around. And without Box Wrecking It, I believe Maurice Blocker beat Marlon Starling for that WBC title, because Simon won the title in 88. They fought in 91. I'm going to go to Maurice Blocker now. I'll let you guys click it so you don't look like, I'm reading it before you do, before I tell you, like I'm a genius. All right. Okay, so that's Box Rec there. There's Maurice Blocker there. So I'm going to click into his res. There it is. Yep. Majority decision win from Marlon Starling. Yeah? He won a majority. That this was just after. This was near. What was this? Starling's last fight? I think this was Starling's last fight. I believe this was Starling's last fight. Just before he, I think he fought Michael Nunn before, then he defended his title against Maurice Blocker. Starling, oh man, I used to hate Marlon Starling. Not because of who he was. He was a great fighter, but the way he beat him, Hunnigan was my dude. He gave Hunnigan such a beating that day. That was horrible that day, man. I hated that. That day was messed up for me. He broke up Hunnigan. He broke him up bad. That like, you know, I was like, oh, man. He just beat the crap out of Hunnigan. He caught Hunnigan early with a big hook, man, and Hunnigan's face just swole up horribly, grotesquely, his cheek. And he said every time Starling hit him, it was like, you know, the pain was just crazy. But anyway, Morris outpointed Starling. In all truth, Marlon Starling shouldn't, like, a few people would get pissed off. Marlon Starling shouldn't lose to guys like Pedro Vieira. He really shouldn't really lose to Maurice Blocker. Because I believe he's way better than them guys. But if you caught Marlon Starling on the wrong day or the right day, like I think guys like Tommy Ayres got over on him, you could beat Marlon Starling. Even Pedro Vieira, who came over to the UK and got beaten up by Sylvester Mitzi. If you got Marlon Starling on the right day, you'd beat him. But Marlon was a quality operator. He was a quality operator. So yeah, he won the belt from Marlon Starling. And I think they was a little reluctant to fight each other because they was really good friends. They was really good friends. But anyway, like Simon took care of business and TKO'd him in the 10th. He TKO'd him in the 10th. And Simon, you know, like he was one of the best fighters of his generation. And don't let anyone tell you any different, man. Any different. He was exciting. He was competent. Very competent. Very gifted. Very talented. His skill set was underrated. Hard puncher. Right? Durable. Everything. Like, Simon was good, man. Simon was like, I remember Simon's early career. And at the time, there wasn't no internet, man. I just had my boxing magazines, and I'm in England. I couldn't get access to some of these fights, man. Like, Simon, his first defeat was actually to Marlon Starling. He had an early points loss to Marlon Starling. And they threw him in with Sean O'Sullivan. It was Sean O'Sullivan. Sean O'Sullivan was a silver medalist in the Olympics. I think either light, was it? Can't remember, was it welter? He lost to Frank Tate in the final. It was probably light. Did I have light middleweight then? Or welter? I think it was welterweight. But I mean, like Frank Tate filled out to be a middleweight Indian. But they threw him in early. They threw him in early with Sean O'Sullivan, man. And Sean O'Sullivan was a Canadian guy, a white guy. And like, he was basically a product of his environment at the time. Like, let me tell you about 80s boxing a little. Like, and don't let anyone tell you any different. This is what it was. In America, you get like people on the fringes, like of promotion and training, like white people are saying, well, yeah, well, we're glad to have this white guy because you can sell him more. And they weren't saying it in a racist way. It wasn't racist. It was just a reality of the game for white guys to promote because it was just easier. Obtain a fan base quicker. And the endorsements and whatnot, that's what it was. They were always looking for the perfect white guy. And they had a couple from Canada. They had Sean O'Sullivan and they had Donnie Lalonde, who I interviewed. Although Donnie wasn't really like Sean. Donnie actually came into the game as an underdog. And he overachieved from what a lot of people said. But Sean O'Sullivan, oh, 11-0. And they were building him up. It was in Canada. That's the kind of prospect he was like, you know, Simon had to travel. And Simon beat the crap out of Sean, man, and basically ruined his career. In fact, let me put Sean on my list. I've done a list of fighters who were supposed to do big things and never managed it. Let me put Sean O'Sullivan on the list, man. I'm going to do the video later. And Sean's story is horrible. Sean O'Sullivan's story is bloody horrible, man. Like, at the time I started getting, I had broadband in my house. That 2005, 2006, or whatever time it was. And I didn't know what happened to Sean O'Sullivan. I didn't know. Okay, he didn't make it. And he just retired. You know, he just retired and faded out. Listen, man, listen, Sean is like, pugilist syndrome poster boy. Horrible. I saw a documentary, I came back by accident. And I remember I saw the guy's face on the screen. And even though he's a little impaired, I recognized his features a little. And then I read the top, that's Sean O'Sullivan. He's messed up badly, man. And Simon Brown put him on that road, man. And back to Simon Brown, man. Like, he fought Bernard Hopkins. He lost to Hopkins. Got stopped. Like that. That was in his twilight years, so to speak. And there was one fight with Simon Brown that really hurt me, man. Like, before I finish, man, I remember that time, man. Like, because what I used to do back then, yeah, I used to know the fights were coming on ITV. I knew when it was scheduled to be on. So what I would do, I would just, like, avoid the result because they were pre-recorded. It was the event had already happened. It was pre-recorded. So I'd avoid the result. So it was like I'm watching it live. And I remember this was on, they put it on Sunday afternoon, man. This was on Sunday afternoon. Terry Norris, this was for the junior middleweight title, the WBC. Terry Norris took on Simon Brown. And let me tell you, man, Simon Brown, he bounced Norris off the canvas, man, and knocked him the fuck out, man. We were just celebrating in his yard. And then Norris got him back and outpointed him. And where was the fight, man? It's Vince Petway, man. I know it's Vince Petway. I know it's the Vince Petway fight. Let me see. Yes, it's the Vince Petway fight. That fight was horrible, man. Like, yeah, IBF super middleweight title. He knocked Simon out. And Simon was on the canvas, still punching. He's on the canvas punching. It was like, what the fuck? What the hell is this? He was on the canvas punching, man. Crazy. It's just crazy, man. It's one of the craziest boxing moments, man. The man was on the canvas, still throwing punches. Knocked out. Frame punches on the canvas. You've never seen the likes of it. But, you know, he was a really good fighter, man. That's one of my favorite fighters, man, Simon Brown. Definitely one of my favorites, you know. He'd be a match for anyone. I don't care. You pick Simon in with anyone. He's either going to beat them or get him a war. Simon was bad, man. Simon was bad. Simon was a bad dude, man. Simon was a bad man. And now we have MAS45678. It says 15 rounds is better. You will have to train harder. Yeah. Simo A says 15 rounds made body shots more effective. That's a very good point, Simo. That's where Ray Lennon's body work became effective against. That's a great point. It's actually a very good point. It's like a simple point to point out, but it's a very good point. He says, some fights, when a fighter does good body work, it starts to show in around the 11th and 12th when the fight is over. That's a very good point. That is a very good point. That's a very good point. Can't argue with that one there. Okay. I'm kind of enjoying this video. I'm not doing it at the speed. If I had pre-recorded it and set everything up and got my notes and then, yeah, I could have had it nice and polished, but, you know, enjoying this. I'm kind of enjoying this. You know, and then we got this one here. What's the next fight? Let me dig up the next fight. My picture slide is messing around right now, so it's not letting me get as I would like. One sec, people. What's the matter with this picture thing? What's the matter with this thing? Yeah, man. Fights, obviously, I mean, like, I didn't realize that there was so much of them in the 80s and 90s. And, it's good. I like going back to this era, man. It's fine with me. Going back to this era is perfectly all right with me. We can do this any day. One sec, people. I'm just trying to hook this up. Where is it? Like it's disappeared. Right. Open! Motherfucker! God almighty. All right, there we go. All right, guys, can you see it? It's De La Hoya versus Trinidad. That was, Oscar had the WBC belt. Trinidad was definitely IBF. You don't need to box around that because Trinidad defended that title so many times. Yeah. Now we're fully into the 12 round mode, so you won't see them big scorecards right now. You won't be seeing that. Oscar was just recently coming off that controversial split decision win with Ike Quarty. For some reason, there was two British judges there in the Thomas and Mack that night. He was a little lucky. I don't think Quarty was a good fight, and he beat Obakar, obviously. You know, he already he got lucky against Pernell Whitaker. I think he was lucky, actually. And it was ridiculous how he got the UD that night, in my opinion. But when people say that Oscar was robbed against Trinidad, was he robbed? Was Oscar robbed against Trinidad? Was he robbed? Did he switch off too early, or was he robbed? Or you see, Lampley, or was it like, they were really bigging up Oscar's boxing, and he did box well. But I've seen other people box like that, and they call it running. Boxing is way my Oscar, you know what I mean? Basically, Trinidad was rewarded for his late finish. Brother Eli said he got on that bike and ran. It's funny. I agree. Well, if they're going to say other boxers are running, so did Oscar. Yeah, I agree with you. If they're going to say other boxers were running, well, that's what Oscar was doing. Oscar was on his trotting. He was off. And Oscar, you know, he came up short. Trinidad kept coming forward, kept trying to be aggressive, and he was rewarded with a split decision win. This was in 1999 at the Thomas and Mack. I don't think it's as eventful as some of the other fights we've covered. But, you know, it's there. It's controversial, and you know it will always be a talking point. Did Oscar shut down too early, or was he blatantly robbed? There was other ulterior conspiracy theories on why it was taken away from him. I can't remember them. But it's one of them ones, you know. It's one of them ones. One of them ones, man. And this one here was awful, man. Might as well move on. You know what I mean? This one here was awful. The next one, I just didn't see it coming. I don't think no one saw this one coming. I don't think no one saw this next one coming. Let me use another. I can't use that slide on this guy. I mean, I've got a slide where he's taking a punch where that doesn't really reflect what happened in the fight. So I have to change the slide. I have to change the slide. Anyone remember this one? Like, how did this happen, man? How did this fucking unrefined ruffian? This was in 2003, man. 2003. It was early 2003 when Ricardo Mayorga, the WBA champion, took Vernon Forrest out in three rounds. Vernon Forrest was just coming off them two Shane Mosley wins, yeah? Anyone remember that? Anyone remember that? Two wins against Shane Mosley, and all of a sudden he was this big player in boxing. But you know something? As much as I admire Vernon Forrest and I like him as an individual and a boxer, I was always a bit pissed off that he beat Shane. And the reason was, I knew he wasn't going to be able to replicate that form as consistently to make him a great fighter. I knew, and like, he didn't. I said, he beat Shane twice. I bet you any money that he doesn't follow this up. You know, and like, Mayorga just flipping, just clowned him, man. Like, Mayorga was a wild, for those who don't know, right? This guy, Mayorga, a Latin fighter. What part of the world is Mayorga from? Ricardo Mayorga is from, where is he from? Nicaragua. He's a Nicaraguan. Chain smoking, cigarette smoking, loudmouth, El Matador. Apparently someone snuffed him the other day in Nicaragua. You know, he'd just get up in your face and just be totally crude, nasty, and say all types of madness, Don King promoted. And it was just strange, man. The fight was just bloody strange, man. Strange. Look at the way how Corey Spinks, I just got the Boxer Cup, and they had it a majority decision, but Corey handled him easy. Corey handled this guy. You wonder how Vernon lost the fight. It was very close. The second fight was a draw, but the first fight, what happened to Vernon Forrest that day, man? He got TKO'd in three. He was just getting caught by all types of sucker punches. And I just have to believe that Mayorga's unorthodox style and the smack talk just got into his head and just, you know, it took him away from his boxing construct. It messed him up. It had him a bit discombobulated, like it's got me right now. And I remember when they put it on BBC. And I watched it, and like I was just like, "Oh my god, what's happening here, man?" I remember he drew him in, and Vernon looked a bit perplexed, and he just swung over his big right hand. I see Vernon just slump over the right hand. The fight was done. I said, "Oh shit." Brother Eli says, Vernon was thrown off by Mayorga's antics. Dude was nutty, for real. Yeah, he was just a crazy man. Just a crazy man. Simo A says, glad Oscar got the gift against Sturm. I'm sorry, but I wanted to see Oscar versus B-Hop, not Sturm. Simo A, wrong for me to say that, but I can be a snob sometimes. Just want to see big names fight. Simo A, but Yoga should be a commentator. Oh my God, that would be some shit. Brother Eli, he was that type of guy that would call TCH right in front of you. Yeah. He's just a nut job. And like I remember in the second fight when he gave Vernon the free shot and Vernon clapped him on the chin and like, yeah, he took the punch and he went to a split. The second one was a classic fight though. Really good fight. Was a really good fight. Second one was excellent. And okay, we have what's this one? This one here is, let me get the picture slide up. Get this picture slide to work a bit better. That would really help. It's just messing up. The second fight, I'm just trying to get the picture slide up. One sec, guys. Right. Let's stop the picture. Let's go here. Corey Spinks versus Mayorga. Right. Corey Spinks versus Mayorga. If I'd done this yesterday, I wouldn't have to remember so much while fresh in my brain. But right now, it's kind of Yes, y'all. You don't. Yeah. I'm trying to remember the timeline. I've actually lost the timeline of what happened and how this bout came about, to be honest. I'll be perfectly honest. I saw the fight, but I can't remember. Because I remember him, Corey beat Zab. They floored each other in the first fight. Both floored each other. And Corey got the win. And then Zab won it after. And, right, let me see. Who won the thing? Right. This must be about 2010. No, he lost to Bundridge by then. So let me see. Mayorga. Where's Mayorga? He beat Mayorga about 2010. No, it weren't that late. Alright, let me just check the source. Let me check the source, that'll help. This was No, it was all free. It was all free. What am I doing? All free. Right. So, got the box rec up. Okay. He beat the Italian guy. Piccirillo, I've never seen that fight. I've never seen it. Was that for the vacant? No, I don't think it was for the vacant. I think the Italian actually had the belt. That was in Italy. 12 round UD. And he took on Mayorga, who had the WBA and WBC belts after obviously he took all Vernon's shit. just wrecked Vernon, boy. I think, who did he beat? Andrew Sixheads for the other belt? So who did Mayorga beat? And yeah, basically he outboxed him for some reason. They had a majority draw. I don't agree, you know. We got my man Black Latin Caesar. He says Tito uppercut the nicotine Mayorga. He says that wasn't even prime Tito. Trinidad at 147 was the true Tito. Eli says he tried that shit with Tito too, got floored that time though. Yeah, it didn't work. It just didn't work. So yeah. who was obviously a relation of the famous Spinks clan. I was actually watching Leon Spinks today, watching Leon Spinks and Muhammad Ali. And it was weird, man. I was watching it. And then I started saying to myself, yeah, Muhammad Ali is dead. And I had to try and convince myself that he was dead. It was like, weird, man. Yeah, man, it's gone. It's gone. It's gone. It's gone. And just not having Ali on the planet. I was trying to convince myself. Yeah, he's gone. Like, wow. And yeah, he's a relative. What side is he? I think he's on Leon's side. I think he's from Leon's side. I'm not actually quite sure. He's a Sphinx, though. He's a Sphinx. Michael, Leon, and I think Leon Sphinx Jr. I think there's another one fighting now. That's a fighting dynasty right there. And Corey was good. Corey was good in his own right, you know. Let's not get that twisted, you know. The Zab Judah fight, both of Zab Judah fights were good. Both of them were good. Both of them were good. Like, he was schooling Zab, boy. Zab was closing the gap in the first one, and he went to points. Great fight. Really good fight. And I think after Zab KO'd him, that was kind of the end of the road for him. Although, he gave Jermaine Taylor a good battle. He gave Jermaine Taylor a good little battle. He did. When everybody thought that Jermaine was going to crush him. Mayorga, he went on to cause havoc. You know, when I say cause havoc, like, just stir up animosity and beef. That's what he did best. That dude was just an animal, man. Turner, he says, Leon's son. Yeah, that's right. Leon's son. You know? Brother Eli, he sent Maurice Blocker to another dimension. Who's that? Simon Brown? Oh. Tito was missing about 147. He just, how much time did he defend that belt, man? Loads. Loads and loads and loads and loads and loads and loads. All right, next fight. Next. Okay, we got this one. One's more familiar. Not really much to say, really, because everybody knows. These are like no-brainers, I guess. The money man. TB Mayweather. Okay, the first fight was in 2014. Was this part of the Showtime contract? I believe it was. Yes, it was. This was part of the Showtime contract. And Floyd was obviously Floyd had McDonough had McDonough had the WBA. He had Broner's WBA belt, which Broner won from, he won it from Paulie? He won it from Paulie, didn't he? Yeah. And obviously he saw McDonough, broke up Adrian Broner, floored him twice and upset him over 12 rounds, and he became WBA champion. And Floyd kind of stolen Broner. Broner wanted an immediate rematch, but Floyd said, yo, no, let me handle this, man. You know what I mean? So Floyd put his green belt up against Madonna's black belt and schooled him. Well, he didn't school him. He got roughed up. Oh, Brother Eli thinks Mayweather really lost that one. Okay, we got to keep it funky. Too much MMA tactics for me. Not enough clean work, but a lot of people agree with you. Some people have it closer. Black Latin Caesar, he says, Floyd has had some very close fights. I think all boxers through history have had some close fights. Maidana, underrated man, fought around the world against fighters he was supposed to lose to. Maidana was underrated. Maidana was underrated. He was definitely undervalued and His story is definitely undertold. Definitely so. Definitely so. And when he went with Robert Garcia, it seemed like he improved as a boxer. When he was fighting the likes of Victor Ortiz, which was a great fight, actually. The fight was excellent. Excellent fight, man. That's the first time I heard of him, really. That's the first time I heard of Marcus Maidana. I heard of Victor Ortiz because he was one of Golden Boy's earliest prospects and stuff like that, and like he was being talked up. And then bang. He made his name. Marcus Maidana made his name, made his mark. You know? He lost the first one by majority. It was a little too close for Floyd's liking. Definitely so. Some of you guys have seen it. It was very close. Says Madonna fought Kotelnik, Khan, Ortiz, Devin, Broner, Droid, Jose Cito, etc. Oh, he went in hard, man. He went in hard. Black Latin season. Madonna gets back in shape, he would be a top five welterweight. Not now. It's too late for him now, you know, to drop all that. He'd have to be the only way he could be a top welterweight again. He'd have to have lost all his money and just recapture that hunger. I don't see it. Brother Eli, he ain't coming back, champ. He's on the ranch chilling with his family and guns. A rich man. Listen, you see, that's the thing, right? You see, you guys are over in America. I'm over here in Britain. We need a lot of financial stuff to make us smile. Oh, a lot of material stuff. Man, he would do little hunting. You know, he'd do little hunting, got his guns, like you say, cooked some food, got his family there, his kids, and sing and drink and sing and eat. He's all right. He's all right. He ain't blowing off all that money. I don't think he's going to blow that money. He's got Floyd to thank for that, though. Black Latin Caesar, I was just wondering, Beats, if he came back. It was a question. Yeah, I know it's a question. I'm just thinking. I think while he was active, he always stays top five. I agree with that. I think if he came back after all the time, I'm just dealing with the circumstances as they are now. He weighs about 16 stone or something like that now. Yeah, I don't think he'd be effective after draining all that weight. The inactivity, he's old now. I think he'd be an easy prey for these guys who've been training regular. I think he'd be easy prey. You know, I think he'd be easy prey, man. Simo says, Maidana never bitch, just got on with it. So financially secure, yeah, he sure is. Sure, I ain't gonna lie, man. I think Floyd won the first fight, but I was happy when the last bell was rang. I was kind of happy. Get the last bell. Get rid of this motherfucker. Get him out of there. Kind of like the Rocky film, but it ain't gonna be no rematch. Oh dear. Maidana versus Bradley is a good matchup. Similarly, it's a good matchup. So that got Floyd two belts. And then, you know, what's the last one? We have this one here. Some people say it was a bore. Depends on what you were looking at and what you wanted. Pacquiao, Freud punches all wild and shit. Freddie ain't teaching no technique or style and shit. Yeah, there's a Pacquiao versus Floyd. This was in 2015. For the sec, that's just for his 48th fight. And obviously, Floyd had the WBC, WBA. Kell Brook still had the IBF and still has it today. And Manny had the WBO. What can I say? I mean, listen, I don't think there's not going to be too many in the chat section who think Pacquiao didn't win. It was a sparring session. Yeah? How much did Floyd make? Was it 300 million or something like that? Was it 300 mil? 300 mil, was it? It's a lot of money. Yeah, Floyd just breezed past it, man. Like, I knew Floyd was going to win the fight. I think threat to Floyd was one punch incapacitated him, KO'd him. There was no way Pacquiao could beat Floyd. They're competing skill to skill. I never saw how Pacquiao was going to... That's why I wasn't disappointed. A lot of people were disappointed. But I always wonder... Now, let's not get it twisted. You know what I mean? Like, when we done the breakdown for Lomachenko, the tell of the tape for Lomachenko and Walters, some people think it was a little biased. But I don't think it was. I think some of it was partly because we wanted Walters to win. I think Walters had achieved more than Lomachenko. And that's what the panel was, well, I was hosting. But this one here, I just didn't see, like people say you can't use triangle theories, but we got more than triangles on this one. We got hexagons and circles and squares, right? Watch Floyd versus Marquez. Watch that. I'll tell you what fight you can even watch. Watch Floyd versus Hatton. Compared to Pacquiao, forget the KO. Look how close Pacquiao lets Hatton get to it. Look how close Pacquiao lets Hatton get to it. Forget the knockout. Right? Look how Morales dealt with Pacquiao. I knew Pacquiao could beat Floyd, so I wasn't disappointed. I saw it, I predicted it, I got my prediction video down. Yeah, Pacquiao Floyd's gonna win. I lost subs because I broke it down like Pacquiao was just another fighter, and they didn't like it. Oh, you see, that's why I don't like this channel, because it's biased. Nah, it wasn't biased. That's just how I saw the fight. I just saw if Floyd boxed to instruction, Pacquiao wouldn't get close to him. And that's what happened. You know? And I'm afraid that people were upset. But what were people really expecting? Were they expecting Manny to out-jab Floyd? Because for him to compete, he's going to have to be able to land some jabs. He doesn't fight like Madonna. He's going to have to really rough Floyd up. See, Cotto managed to make it competitive because he had the jab. Madonna used MMA to a lot. He got away with a lot, to be honest. Like, a lot of people won't admit that Madonna got away with a whole lot in that fight. Like, he shouldn't have. You know? Yeah, so that's the highest grossing fight in boxing history, I believe. Yes, it is. Both men walked away with a fortune. Pacquiao made excuse after excuse after excuse. And Floyd had one fight on the Showtime contract, and then, you know, it was a wrap. And then on March the 5th, this is where we're at. This is where we're at, man. This is the big one, fellas. What do you think? Danny Garcia versus Keith Thurman. Danny, 32-0 with 18 KOs, man. Keith Thurman is 27-0 with 22 KOs. Yo. What do you reckon? Simo A says Floyd could have dropped him and turned it on. I think Floyd could have done more damage to Pac. That's the only thing I'd say with Floyd is that I think he could have done more damage. Although it would have probably put him in the line of Pacquiao's power. That's the only thing that lacked in that performance. And if I'm gonna measure it at the tightest level of the greatest ever fighters, then we have to judge it harshly. Sugar Ray Leonard fought very cautiously against Hagler. He did, but we have to look at the circumstances. Hagler was maybe the strongest middleweight ever. Yeah? Or one of them. He was a 7-year reigning champion at middleweight. So Leonard fought cautiously. Leonard had never fought a middleweight title fight. He had fought middleweights like Marcus Giraldo. And he fought light middleweights like Ayub Kalouli. But he had never fought a middleweight champion, a middleweight at the level of Marvin Hagler. So he fought cautiously. But Floyd against Pacquiao, let's be extra clear. He won the fight, clearly. And I guess that's all that counts. He won the fight. And that's all he wanted to do. What Floyd, the problem with what happened with Floyd on the night is he got caught up in win at all cost. And he didn't think about the historical impact. If you really want to put the icing on the cherry, if you want to just go beyond the win is all that counts, he needed to put some hands. When Terrence beat Terrence Crawford, I know it's not the biggest fight as Manny and Floyd, but when Terrence beat Postol, yeah, Terrence fought cautiously at times. He fought cautiously. He used his back foot, but he made sure that he drilled my guy with enough hard punches that you had something to go back to when you're rewatching the film. Yeah, so remember he floored him, remember he hit him like that, remember he two-pieced him up here, two-pieced him there. Floyd should have put my hands on him. That's all I'd say. He should have put, considering it was the highest grossing fight ever. And if we compare it to Sugar Ray Leonard and Hearns and Duran middleweight clashes, we'd probably expect a little more in terms of offense. But in terms of boxing, which ultimately that's all that counts, yo. He schooled him. And there was never going to be any other result anyway. There was never going to be any other result. Floyd was always better than Manny Pacquiao. Always better than Manny. Always. You know, so we go into the Thurmanator, as brother Eli calls him. I mean, then we got MAS 45678. He's looking forward to it. He said the Thurmanator is going to beat the brakes off Danny. What's going to make it so bad is Danny is tough, so it's going to be a sustained, brutal beating. The judges won't save him this time. Ooh. Simo A, Garcia's experience will get him through. Some fighters are better when they are underdogs. Garcia, unanimous decision. That's a very good point. Simo A, I'll be very impressed with some of your comments this hangout. That's a very good point. That's a very good play. Most people thought Matisse was going to knock out Garcia. And they spoke about his power like they're speaking about Thurman's power now. Yeah? They spoke about that. People underestimate Danny's power. People underestimate Danny's boxing ability. People underestimate Danny's chin. People underestimate Danny's heart, his will, and a lot of other stuff. They do. They do. They do. They do. They do. Now, he's had a few dodgy ones. He definitely lost against Herrera. He didn't win that. And but Thurman don't box like Herrera. He doesn't box like that. He doesn't box like that. He's not watching all types of angles. He's just looking to get hard shots in, and then he bounces back out more randomly. He's not like Herrera studied black fighters to get his style. To get his stuff. That's what he did. Herrera's checking angles, he dips and shit. And he's checking range. It's not really Thurman's craft like that, I'm afraid. So, Brother Eli, my prediction is Thurman eventually knocking Danny out late. If his face holds up, he eats jabs like a Skittle. Yeah, and if Danny goes to Thurman's body and lands that left, what if Danny lands that left hook? Let's get both their box wrecks up, man. I can't wait for this one, man. I'm telling you, man, we got some great welterweight clashes coming, man. We got some great. This is where the welterweight division is in a great position right now, man. Great position. Let me put these bad boys up, man. Yeah, I've got to get up early in the morning, but fuck that, man. Let me do this, man. Okay. Let's get the box racks up. That's Keith's. Keefy Keith. Danny Garcia. Not to be confused with the guy Roy Jones. Roy Jones knocked out someone named Danny Garcia, didn't he? Back in there. Not to be confused with him. So, go last five bouts, fellas. Let's go last five. Last five bouts. Kind of inactive, man. All right, so 2014, he's had five fights since 2014. That's quite inactive. Okay, Julio Diaz. That was in early 2014, Julio Diaz. As well, yeah, not really, yeah. Rod Salka. That brutal ass KO. That KO was, oh gosh. I might go and watch that after I finished. I've got a bunch of KOs on speed dial, man. And that's one of them. Leonard Bundu, UD. Go back to Diaz fight. Some people said that Diaz was outboxing Thurman. Did I miss something? Because I don't see certain things that people saw. I just saw him just get beaten up and then retired. I didn't see that. That's what, you know. Leonard Bundu extended him for this was for the interim WBA world title. And we saw what Errol Spence did to Bundu. We saw. Bundu was floored in the first, but after that, he was never troubled. He was never troubled again. Lamont Peterson for Danny Garcia. Now, I was watching this on Skype with the dudes. And for some reason, I had Danny winning. And when I watched it again, Lamont Peterson won the fight. He was lucky to win that. In my opinion, he was lucky. It was at a catch weight. This is early PBC. This is one of the PBC classics. You know? Where does time go, man? Where does time just flip? Listen, man, tell anyone out there, don't waste your time in life, man. Get things done, because I'm just thinking, man, like Robert Barrero was a fight was 2015. I can't believe with Keith Thurman. Was it that long ago? yesterday, man. They both fought Guerrero, both went the distance with Guerrero. Thurman managed to floor him in the ninth, the canvas, and kind of got at Keith a little. He had a massive swelling on his face the next day, a massive swelling. Yeah? But it was a good boxing display. It was a good, and then, who was Danny's next fight? Paulie Malignaggi. He shut Malignaggi down to Danny, just outboxed him. Intelligent pressure is what he used. Closed the range down on him and just stopped him, man. Like the referee Arthur McCante Jr. just he wisely stopped it because Paulie was a bucket load behind on the scorecard, you know, a bucket load of points behind, and the shots were coming more and more accurate, and they were becoming more heavy and accurate, and there was no sense in letting it continue. I thought that was the last we were going to see Paulie in the ring. He's going to fight in England against Sam Eggington. And then we go to Louis Collazo. We got the Louis Collazo fight. That was 2015. The body shot fight, I guess that was. That's the fight. That's the... yeah. I suppose the only criticism I have is Keith doesn't have that Joe Louis thing where Joe Louis would hide if you were hurt. He'd hide it. Keith just keep kind of like, oh, I wanted to express my pain. And you can see it. Like, Keith is like wincing, man. Like, interesting fight if that cut didn't manifest on Louis Collazo. I believe it was very interesting. Then we have Robert Guerrero for Danny Garcia. That was for the vacant WBC world title. What Garcia was doing fighting for a vacant title. Uncle Al. That was Uncle Al. Uncle Al. Future with the funk. Unanimous decision. Some people... Floyd said that Guerrero won it, which he didn't. Some people said that Guerrero won it. And normally I don't critique people's scoring of fights. If you scored it for Guerrero, you don't know shit about boxing. I'll say that. Guerrero himself said that Keith hits harder. I understand what Guerrero's saying. But understand this. Didn't fight to land power punches. Danny fought on the back foot. He fought on the back. And I think Keith Thurman can bang harder than Danny. Let's not get that twisted. I'm not trying to be clever here. I think Keith can bang harder than Danny. But the reason Guerrero didn't punches is because Danny knew he was younger, fresher and faster, and that's all he had to train to do was just sidestep around my guy's brushes and just touch him with the jab, touch him here, touch him there, throw a two-piece here, get out at the sides here, and that's what he did. He didn't try and blast Guerrero out. He didn't even try. He could have mixed it up more, but that's listen. And this is in hindsight. I wouldn't have been, what I'm going to say here, I wouldn't have been able to say it beforehand because I'm not a boxing coach. In hindsight, you have to look at how Guerrero fights. If you're Angel Garcia and you're studying Guerrero, what's the only way he even gets a chance to compete with a young lion like Danny? Danny has to give up his advantages. Right? The only chance Guerrero had was if Danny stood in the pocket and started swinging with it. So did. That was his, and Danny didn't give him that. Danny didn't give him that, he just boxed him. He boxed him. All right, let's see what's happening here. I'll go to the last opponents in a minute when I can get you back, you guys back on the screen. Let's see what you're saying. I'm interested in the Garcia comments. Very interesting. Yes. Okay. Yeah, we got Brother Eli asks Chavez about Thurman's angle when ran him into a train. Okay. Simo A, Garcia had the perfect fights to perform against a Thurman. Nate Campbell, Holt, Khan, Matisse, Garcia look very calm in interviews. Yes, he's got a good temperament, Danny, as well. That's what could see. Has Keith got the temperament? Because Keith, we've seen Keith in a, just like not. I'm not saying he's been on the brink so much. Bit panicked in certain situations. Danny is very calm, or at least see Danny disguises. Remember what I was saying? Keith doesn't hide the pain. Danny has been hurt. In fact, I think Zab Judah hurt him. But Danny disguises it. Danny doesn't let it on. Doesn't Danny? That's that old school shit. MAS 45678. Danny left hook is not to be played with in the mid rounds. Oh, it's a dangerous weapon. Simo A, what do you think about Angel's comments that people told him Thurman is a heavy drinker? Is that why Collazo effed him up in the body? Oof. I didn't know about that. I didn't know about that at all. 4567. I'll look into it though. 4567. Khan took the fight to Danny and got laid out. Khan was busting Danny's ass up until that point, in my opinion. I think Danny was he was finding the range. It wasn't a lucky punch. I tell people that much. It wasn't a lucky punch. Main Tarzan beats boxer than Lamont Peterson, and also more power than Lamont Peterson. Because then he can style on Danny, slow feet. I think Lamont's the better boxer. He just doesn't have Thurman's power. I think Lamont Peterson's a better boxer. Thurman has big power. He's got very big power. Simo A, Danny fights to the level of his opponents. I expect him to step up. That's a good point. Can't wait. It's a great fight. Brother Eli, Danny is kind of fucked up in a way because if Lamont wins on Saturday, the belt loses to Thurman, the run back is next. Yeah, that could be interesting. If Peterson wins a belt Saturday. Brother Eli, he damn sure won't anywhere near Keith again. Caesar, Eli, don't sleep on Garcia. Brother Eli, Danny is a good boxer, good fighter, very good. However, he is in way over his head this time. That I disagree with. I vehemently disagree with. This is Keith Thurman's hardest fight. Yeah, I don't care if you're a Keith Thurman fan. If you haven't acknowledged that this is Keith Thurman's hardest fight, then you've been sleeping. Game right there. You're sleeping on game. This is Keith Thurman's toughest fight. There's no doubt about that. This is Danny Garcia's toughest fight. This is both of their toughest fight. And it's not just because of their abilities. You know, they're both getting full training camps. They're both undefeated. They're both relatively experienced guys now. All right? There's a lot of pressure. The pressure is here. There's a lot of pressure on them. There's a lot of expectation. There's a lot to lose. They both hit hard. They're both good boxers. They both managed to stay unbeaten for a number of years. This is the toughest fight for both guys. And a lot of people are writing down, I've actually got Thurman the favorite, but I'm not scoring, or I'm not predicting KO. I'm not predicting points. I'm not predicting that. I just think maybe Thurman could edge it. Could edge it. But this is, it's a great matchup, man. Great matchup. Great matchup. I love this fight. I love it to death. This fight to death, man. Black Latin Caesar. Garcia is a small welter that came up in weight and has a strong resume. One of the best resumes in boxing. Brother Eli, he agrees. Yeah, yes, this, see, that's the thing. He does have a very strong resume. Black Latin Caesar. Danny's patience and timing will pay off versus Keith. Please remember that Keith Thurman blocked punches. Yes, he does. Yes, he does. Yes, he does. I see a lot of Thurman supporters, they're New Jack supporters, and they don't know nothing. Like, I was talking to my friend the other day who works in the gym. Catching jabs on your gloves, on your shoulders and stuff. It's not really Keith's game. Right? If Porter was able to steady himself and get the trajectory of some of his shots, he would have lost the fight. Thurman would have lost the fight. Danny has way better trajectory and accuracy over his shots than Sean Porter. His timing is way better. He's way more measured than Sean Porter. I'm telling you, man. Telling you. Don't be surprised to see Keith Thurman on the canvas. Don't be shocked. But I expect him to, if he does, I expect him to get up and battle on. Don't be shocked to see Danny on the canvas. This is a great battle. A great battle. It's a great battle. And the reason I wanted to cover it after I got the article, because I'm thinking, man, sometimes we talk about old school boxing, but we've got a great fight in front of us, man. A barnstormer. This is a barnstormer. I kicked over my bottle of water, so it's not good. It's not good. But all right, we're back. We're back. We're back. What we got? Rob Gotti says, "What's good, Beats? What's good, Rob?" He's got Thurman by UD. Brother Eli, Beats, just make sure you go live after the scrap. I'll be there. 100%, 100%. Simo A, even if Khan was doing him, so what? Khan had never been dropped at 140, was unified champ. Danny, conclusively, only one to beat him conclusively at 140. Yeah? Mr. Doc, this is the kind of fight that boxing needs. Yes, 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 yes. Yes. This is... It just shows Al Heyman's intentions, man. Look what Al's doing in the welterweight. These are both Al managed fighters. In probably this is the matchup of the year so far. I can't. Well, we've got Joshua and Klitschko. I think this is a better fight. I think this is the better fight personally. We've got this, and now we have another of his advice fighters against Kell Brook. Good shit. Good shit, bro. Good shit. Welterweight division looking good. Brother Eli, Danny eats punches too now. Let's be real. It depends how he boxes. That's a good point. All right. Okay, I concede a little. I who's got a better defense though? Brother Eli, good for the fam. I don't know. Maybe it's like what I said. Danny hides his pain a bit better than Thurman, I think. And we haven't really seen him hurt to the body like that, or really hurt to the head. Thurman, we've seen a few. Like the Salto Caras caught him with a good little shot. But, you know, if Porter didn't fall over himself and into clinches, it's like saying if Broner got his weight straight. Laughing out loud. Yeah. Yeah, Broner is in that case, man. Black Latin Caesar, Danny has fought way tougher opponents than Keith has. He's fought more names, but have they, at what stage though? Guys like Morales and Kendall Hall, did he get them at the toughest periods? Chavez wasn't bad. Jan Savic, former champions, Quintana. That's what you're saying. They both got good names, man. They both got good names on their resumes, man. They got excellent names on there, man. I'm looking forward to this, man. Looking forward to that one. It's good. The Thurman stopping Garcia late on cuts. Whoa. Man. I'm just saying Thurman for now. I'm saying Thurman, but you never know. I think the only reason I'm picking Thurman is because he's been in the weight class longer. Simo A, what do you think about Angel's comments that people... Oh, yeah, I read that already. I'm going over all ground, man. I'm going over all ground. Simo A, Morales gave Madonna work. Mr. Doc, mummified Morales embarrassed Danny at times the first time. Yeah, he did. Black Latin Caesar, look at every Keith Thurman fight. By the end of the fight, Keith looked like he's been in a car accident. Danny's going to time his ass and pop it. It won't be smothered punches like Porter's. Okay. Let's go to some base level boxing. If both men land their hardest shots, who has the better chin? Who's the stronger guy inside? Is Thurman that much of a harder puncher than Garcia? Thurman has a 69-inch reach. He's 5'7.5". Garcia doesn't have a long reach. I know that for sure. He has a 68.5-inch reach. He's 5'8". What? Garcia's the taller guy? By an inch? They're practically the same size. The inch in height, reach, height advantage, and half an inch reach advantage for Thurman. Danny, 28 years of age. Keith Thurman, 28 years of age. Wow. I tell you what, man, 79% KO success for Keith Thurman and 58% for Danny. This is such a well-matched fight. It's such a well-matched fight. Charles Jackson, he's got Garcia by a robbery, laughing out loud. Mr. Duck. Okay, I'll get to his comment. I'm taking it from early. Mr. Duck, he says, Black Lightning Caesar, I contend that Garcia busts up more easily. Regarding Thurman, Brother Eli, come on, Simo. Morales is a first ballot Hall of Famer easily. Well, that goes without saying. Of course. Charles Jackson, he's got Garcia by a robbery. Simo A says, that's what I'm saying. Mr. Doc, laughing out loud. Good point. Thurman has to do anything he can to avoid it going to the cards. Mr. Buxton today, he's favoring Thurman, 55-45. He's got Thurman at a 55% chance of winning to Danny's 45%. It's tight, man. It's tight, Mr. Buxton today. It's tight. It's tight. This fight is tight. The margins are very tight. They're very tight, man. I'll tell you what it's going to come down to. Right? This is your Uncle Beats talking there, right? Forget who hits harder, who's faster, who's got this record, who's got that. It's going to come down to who can keep their head on the occasion. That's what this is going to boil down to. Yeah? It's who's matured, you know, for a culmination of their careers, who's matured the best at this stage here? Who's got the wisest head? You have to be a smart guy. The smarter guy is going to come out victorious. It's the guy who's, you know, who can steady himself and compose himself the best. That's what it's going to come down to. Because there's a lot of stake, man. There's a lot of stake. Where does the loser go? Depends how they lose, Simo. Depends how they lose. Mr. Doc, if Garcia loses, he could go back to 140. Can he not? He can't get back out to 140. I think he'd chop off his leg. Did you see him standing next to Floyd? In that picture, he looked way bigger than Floyd. He can't get back down to 140. That guy, that boy cannot get back down to 140. No way. No way. Charles Jackson, rematch? Possibly. Simo, if it's a good rematch and it makes sense. He says, nope, he was struggling to make weight at the end. Yeah, 140, that ship has passed. But Danny Garcia, that ship has passed. You know? So this is an excellent scrap, man. An excellent scrap. Boxing 101, this is, boy. Who we got? Kevin, is it? No, Dan Birmingham. How good is Dan Birmingham? Who else is Dan Birmingham? I was thinking of Kevin Cunningham, but I'm demonstrating for someone. I always mix up their names. Who Dan Birmingham, who is he? Did he train Jeff Lacey? Dan Birmingham? Winky Wright. Either Winky Wright or Jess Lacey. I can't remember now, man. I'm trying to remember the guy's resume. Well, I'm trying to get this picture up as well. It was fucking taking so ages to flip and get popping. Man, it doesn't want me to continue. He's saying, go to bed. Brother Eli, rematch. Shit. Did Broner get back in there with Madonna? Well, Madonna wouldn't get back in there with Broner. When you get walloped, you don't risk it nowadays. Herman can fight the loser of Brooke versus Spence. Yeah, that's right. He trained Winky Wright. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Doc. I knew it was Winky. I did say earlier. Black Lantern C, the Thurman biggest advantage is natural size. Keith started before and went to 147. Meanwhile, Danny started at 140 and went up. Rob Gotti, Winky Wright. Yep. Correct you are. Brother Eli and Garcia will be walloped. Mr. Duck. And he was in the Black Mamba's corner versus Chavez the second time. Damn. I don't remember that. Okay. Because Black Mamba was normally Jesse Reed. But by that stage there, I think, wasn't Jesse still there? Being a Black Mamba's trainer. Rob Gotti, Ben Gatti was his first trainer. Didn't Dan Birmingham train Left Hook Lacey as well? Or have I got that incorrect? Yeah, I know Winky Wright, yeah. So I'm just curious to know. Who's the better trainer, though? Who's got the better trainer? Dan Birmingham versus Angel. I think Birmingham's had the more a more variety of different boxers. Who else has Angel coached? Yeah, Jesse Reed. Yeah, Jesse Reed, Mr. Doc. Definitely Jesse Reed. Mr. Doc, Broner actually had to be paid up side money so Floyd could fight Madonna. For better or worse, Broner did want the Madonna rematch. Yeah, he did want it. I think it would have been a mistake for him, though. Mr. Boxing Today says, yep. He all in Florida, guys, man. Winky, Dawson, Lacey, Edna Cherry, and Thurman, and a few others. Yeah. Laughing out loud. Yeah, it's Birmingham. Birmingham's the better coach. Well, not the better coach. Yeah, you'd have to say the better coach, because look at all what he's done with a different range of boxers compared to Angel. Who else has Angel coached? Brother Eli, I can't recall any other fighters Angel's coached. He's put all his energy into Danny. Mr. Doc laughing out loud, Birmingham all day, please. Definitely, so. Yeah, man. All right, let me see if I can get, squeeze out a few more replies from you guys for the depart. It's been good. I've enjoyed it. But we always have good hangouts here, man, you know, because we always connect the new fights to the old school. The old school don't get neglected on you know what I mean? I don't like when the old school gets neglected. Because I don't see how you can honor a sport like boxing and not chain the events together with the old school. I've never understood how other formats work, but I should understand, you know. It's good that some people just deal with what's current. It's good. And then it's good that you've got guys like me, you know, connect both sides of the spectrum, man. You know, it's important. Charlo vacated his title, moving up to 160. Which one? There's two of them, Rob. There's two, bro. I mean, what one? The one who messed up Julian Williams? Oh, yeah, well, you're looking for Triple G. You're looking for trouble, yeah? Looking for Trouble G, bro. You want to fight Trouble G? You got the trouble you need. No. If he lands an uppercut on Triple G, he'll have the whole of Kazakhstan shaking their boots, boy. I mean, Michael Montero and Steve Kim shaking their boots. Shaking in their boots, bro. Yeah. The demographic. Michael Montero and Steve Kim, we call them the demographic, yeah? And the rest of them nut jobs. Jamal. That still don't tell me what one's Jamal. I can't split them. Let me see. Jamal Charlo. Okay, the bad man, the banger, Julian. I tell you what, uppercut, he's a violent little you, isn't he? That fuck was sick, bro. The uppercut was sick. I'm like, whoa, damn. Okay, yeah, I'm on Twitter. Good luck. Keep God first. Alien Boxing. Appreciate Future Boxing for not holding us up to further his career. Okay. Who's he fighting next then, man? I wonder who he's targeting, man. Who's he targeting? I'm on Twitter trying to look who's future of boxing. Why am I not knowing this? Put me up on game, fellas. What's future of boxing? Keep doing your thing, bro. Is that him? Is he the future of boxing? Ah, okay. He's the future of boxing. Okay, he's got a story on vacating the titles on ESPN. Go to it, Beats. Go to it. Go to it. All right. Let's get some of this crap off. I've got too much flipping pages up. Okay, give me a second, fellas. Give me a second. Just waiting for the page to open up. You're on it straight away. All right. We got old Greasy Neck, Dan Raphael. All right, still waiting for it to open. Taking his time. Okay. Jermall Charlo vacates belt, paving the way for Tony Harrison and what's his name? Jarrett Hurd. Jarrett Hurd to fight for the belt next week. Oh, they're going to fight for the vacant belt. You see? He gave them there. You see? He didn't hold the belt up. He didn't keep it with him for extra mileage to say he gave it up so two guys could flip in, get a shot at the belt. I mean, I admire that. He could have held on to that belt, moved up to middle, and said, okay, I'll get rid of it now. But, you know, I admire that from Charlo. A few boxers can look at that example. After Charlo brutally knocked out Julian J. Rock in the fifth to retain his belt for the third time, he said he wanted to unify the division. Those fights, however, were not available to him. Charlo has said he's facing difficulty making the weight. So 160 is where he's heading to. It's either going to be a big fight for me at 154, like Cotto or Canelo, something big like that, or move up, is what he told ESPN. It had to be something big to make it worth staying at 154. I know a lot of people mentioned Demetrius Andrade as far as competition. He wanted that fight, but staying at 154 wasn't the healthiest move. He's been making 154 since he was an amateur in 2007. His body is growing, he says, and it was a little bit of a struggle. Okay. When his twin brother Jermall Charlo knocked out John Jackson in the eighth to win the vacant junior middleweight belt. What belt was that again? Was that IBF? I can't remember now. They became the first twins to hold world titles in the same division. At the same time, they had vowed never to fight each other. Jermall Charlo, 25-0, 19 KOs, 26 years of age, from Houston. He knocked out K9 to win the title in the third. That I'm telling you, man, I with the way he dismounted K9, boy, I remember that, boy. It was like, that was disrespectful, man. That was totally disrespectful. He was just handling K9. K9 ain't been in the ring since. Boy, I ain't seen K9 in the ring since. Oh, shit. Yeah, man. Yeah, he's moving up, man. He's moving up. I think he can definitely be a force at 160. I think he'll be more than equipped to be one of Triple G's best challengers if he can establish himself with a couple of victories. You know? I think so. Yeah, he messed K9 up bad, Mr. Duck. He messed him up. He messed him up bad. Boxing today, off topic. Calzaghe versus Ward. Who wins on their best night at 168? Oh. I don't know, man. I tell you what, though, Mr. Boxing Today. We've got the super middleweight. We're going to do, we used to do them tournaments We've got one coming soon. And the, oh boy, I'm signing off soon. We're gonna have to break it down to 6 fighters, right, in the tournament, and these nutters in my chats, they came up with so much names. They, Joe Calzaghe, Andre Ward, James Toney, Eubanks Sr., Iran Barkley, Roy Jones, Carl Froch, Arthur Abraham, Thomas Hearns, Adonis Stevenson, Steve Collins, Nigel Benn, Mike McCallum, Saban Otka, James DeGale, Bernard Hopkins, Michael Nunn, Miguel Kessler, Sugar Ray Leonard, somebody even said Frankie Lyles. So what we're going to have to vote out a lot of these fights, and then we will be left. I might take Roy Jones out. I'm still thinking of taking Roy Jones out, because I have a feeling if Roy Jones is in it, he just beats then everyone's going to vote for Roy every match. Prime for prime. Who's going to vote against? I don't think no one's going to vote against Roy. So I'm still tempted to take Roy out. Or is that unfair of Roy? Who wins Ward versus Keller? I don't know. That one I don't know. That one I don't know. That one I know. That's a tough fight. That's a tough, tough fight. And an excellent fight. It's a shame it never happened. It's a shame it never happened. But that's the way, man. Some matches we'll never get to see. You know? We'll never get to see some fights, man, and that's one of them. I was always looking forward to seeing Calzaghe fight Dawson, but there was no money in that for Calzaghe at that stage there, wasn't it? And the risk reward, he was never going to take that fight. All right, people. Thanks for the participation. It's a Boxing Beats and Rhymes. Peace.